quarterfinal of Manila Worlds 2013. In opening proposition, please welcome IAUMB. In opening opposition, UP Manila. In closing proposition, IAUMC. The motion reads, this House would limit government ministers' standard of living to that of someone on the current median wage. I know it's very wordy, it was not my choice. Without further ado, though, I call up on the Prime Minister to open the case that stands in her name.
A politician life should be equated with the life of each and every single individual who lives in the state. We then propose from the side of the government that the standard of living of a politician should be equated to each and every single person in the room, but more importantly, on the median or the average income of the country, ladies and gentlemen, average reasonable person quality of living. Mr. Speaker, this debate is for extending the principle, because under status quo, a politician represents the ideals which each and every admission which the country possess, and that's why he got elected. This debate is about extending that principle of representation towards the standard of living which this politician possess. So that's the model we stand for. In the status quo, obviously politicians have kept salary, and at the same time they can earn like extra income, maybe when they give speeches outside universities. So this is the model which we stand for. We're going to cap the expenditure of these politicians, ladies and gentlemen, but even though if it means lowering the income of this politician, we say that's justified. We're going to set this debate in Western liberal democracy. What does this mean? This means that each country will have their own standards. Like in the United States, the income is $47,000 a year. The United Kingdom is $45,000. We're going to follow that standard. But we're going to make this clear, right? This will only be implemented and imposed during the term of this politician. Once this politician has retired, we're going to remove that, ladies and gentlemen. So, I have three arguments to bring to you in this debate. Firstly, the principal argument. Why is it justified to treat ministers as an average reasonable person in that country? Secondly, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to analyse how this creates an impetus for greater accountability for this politician to implement practical change in that country. And thirdly and finally, how this improves the level of politics and governance in that country. On my first argument, before I move on, yes.
Sir, is it not possible to believe in the ideals of good governance, fighting for the rights of people, but at the same time preserving your wealth?
No, I don't believe in that principle, and this nicely moves into my case. Under status quo, ladies and gentlemen, we understand that if a politician is represented, he's usually represented because of the ideals and principles which he stands for. Maybe he's against abortion, ladies and gentlemen. So we say we need to extend that philosophy or that principle not only towards the ideals which he stands for, but also towards the earnings which he gave. Why? Everyone will agree, right, that within a democratic setting, the only reason why the politician is in power is because of the people and because of the mandate of the people. So that means the principle here is that the people act as an employer and the politician is merely an employee within this context, ladies and gentlemen. So this means that the politicians work for the people. So we see in this particular context, ladies and gentlemen, we need to extend this principle towards an average reasonable person or the economic income which an average reasonable person gave. Why is that so? Because we think, ladies and gentlemen, if every single person, like the average income of that person in mind is around $6,000, ladies and gentlemen, that means that politician is accountable towards the income which each and every single person gave in that country. So we see that's the relationship of reciprocity and accountability between these two individuals, ladies and gentlemen. So we see that there is a necessity for us to treat them equally. Sit down. So the principle and philosophy is there. So let's move on to the second practical change on the ground. Because we say, ladies and gentlemen, only when politicians realize that their pocket money is being put at stake, only when they realize that if real change does not happen, if there's real disparity between the rich and poor, and really the income should get in contrast to the income of that country, only then will they have the true incentive to implement practical change on the ground. Why is this so? Because now, ladies and gentlemen, the politicians will have a true incentive to concentrate on economic development of that country. Because if he or she does not do so, he will tangibly be harmed. That means he can't spend as much as possible in contrast to what he can before. His family also can't do that, ladies and gentlemen. What is the conclusion to this? This means that these politicians will no longer be looking at popularity contest. Maybe how do I stand, whether I'm popular or not. These politicians will not only be looking, ladies and gentlemen, on how to beat the opposition by just tainting them with bad images. Now the politicians will concentrate on real economic issues of that country, ladies and gentlemen. Right. And we say there's a tangible benefit, Mr. Speaker, of our policy. Sit down. So let's move on towards the third and final argument, how this improves the level of politics and governance in a country. Let's face the fact of the real world. Even within developing countries, also developed countries, politics is dead. There's constant bickering, ladies and gentlemen, between the opposition and government. And this bickering is not necessarily something which is good, because it's not targeted towards the development of a country, but sometimes it's targeted to bring down the other side by just throwing harsh remarks. Let's look at this, right? Like currently we see that the Democrats, ladies and gentlemen, or the Liberals throwing comments to Sarah Palin because she spends a lot on her lingerie and also on her boyfriend in a particular context. And that's when media constantly sensationalized on this, Mr. Speaker, broke right-wing and left-wing media. Why is that bad? That's bad, ladies and gentlemen, because now the level of intellectual discussion will be reduced, because now voters will make decisions based on the popularity contest, not in terms of real pragmatic change on the economic development of a country. Because now politics in that country have been swayed and diverted. This is the perverse kind of politics in that country, ladies and gentlemen. So what happens here, Mr. Speaker, is the hardest that voters will no longer make an informed decision on economic development of a country, but not based on its popularity contest. So how do we change that, ladies and gentlemen? We change this, ladies and gentlemen, because now the level of discussion in government and opposition will not be on how should I bring the opposition down by saying that they spend a lot, but now we'll bring the only way for me to bring the opposition down is by bringing real practical change on the ground so that each and every single person can benefit and so that I can increase the average income of my country. So now, furthermore, Mr. Speaker, this is the third level, that now politicians will not only look towards the personal interest of him or herself. How should I get a lot of money into my pocket? Now, politicians can't do that itself, ladies and gentlemen. And that's where all the interest, all the times, 24 hours a day, 7 times a week, for like 5 years of that period, will be concentrated on the economic development of a country, Mr. Speaker. So that means you reduce the kind of personal interest which these politicians invest in a particular product. Ladies and gentlemen, I dare say that the representative of my country should be equated as an average reasonable person in that country. For that reason, I'm extremely happy to propose this motion.
I thank the Speaker for his remarks and call upon the Leader of the Opposition to open the case for the opposition side. Hear, hear.
The clash of the opposition is the status quo, where the citizens and members of the parliament are given the natural right and freedom to appreciate life and the standard of living according to their means and capability. For this debate, there are three general ideas we'd like to question. Number one, in terms of philosophy, is this fair and liberal democracy? But second, in terms of pragmatic, is this going to affect the type of governance and effectivity that we have in status quo? But lastly, in terms of principle, in this rights debate, Madam Speaker, is it fair for such a policy to exist within our society? Allow me first to engage the first speaker. Number one, I don't think the Prime Minister was able to establish the link between having your wealth and inability to advocate for particular ideas. We see from side opposition that advocacy of anti or pro-abortion, for example, is not intrinsic within your wealth or your ability to have more property. In fact, we see that representation shouldn't be superficial or basically mimicking the background of your constituents. It seems as if you're a Christian, for example, you can't necessarily advocate for the rights and what is important for the Muslim population. Or for example, if you're a wealthy person, you cannot understand the common advocacies and the problems that we have with the poor right now. Because the principle of this first rebuttal is this: governance and representation extends from mere transitivity of background representation and mimicking, but it's more targeted towards the concrete changes and your capability to enact service and governance to your constituents at the end of the day. Second level of rebuttal is this. He says motivations will be present in their model. Remember, they themselves still operate within a society that elects them eventually. That's precisely the reason why his horns, that there will be bickering, that will be unstable, for example, still exists in his model. But second of all, we twist that. We think that's a positive motivation for this particular politicians. In a society that periodically evaluates their performance, the type of changes that they have in society, we think that preserves their ability to function well and continually promote the ideas that they have. But at a second sub-level, we think accountability do exist. Status quo creates checks and balances that makes sure the type of profit or earnings that they get are not under corrupt means, but under a fair and realistic means of earning your money. But at the last level of rebuttal, we think that the policy of government limits the capability of these governments to expand the services that they have by limiting their basic investments and capital that they have. Because we think that personal wealth and investment on your property, for example, extends to the quality of service that you're going to give to the people. On these multiple levels, the conclusion we take from the side of the house is that wealth does not necessarily mean non-representation of your people, but second of all, your ability to serve as subject to checks and balances by society, and that's a stronger motivation that we have in today's debate. I'm going to run two basic ideas. One, how the policy punishes meritocracy, and number two, the basic ideal of the right to property. The philosophy of the first argument in terms of punishing meritocracy is that we reward individuals who invested in hard work and honesty because we operate in a society that drives us to function. For us to have that sense of assurance that whenever we worked hard, we studied hard, for example, and we were able to expand our wealth because of that particular meritocracy, no thank you, you're able to pursue a higher standard of living. And this is the most and basic fundamental right appropriated and natural right given to individuals. The right to life, not just the mere existence or presence or absence of it, but more importantly, the quality of life that the state affords to you. We say that government ministers are first citizens of the state before they become ministers of the parliament. And a social contract exists before them and assures them those basic liberties. Because in status quo, there are high thresholds before we start clamping on these particular rights. For example, we restrict the right of criminals or terrorists for the right to mobility because they're a threat to society and you may instill clear and tangible harms to the rest of the society. Or you may restrict the freedom to expression if it entails a global or national security threat. In this case, we think that the policy of governmental thinking is punitive without appropriately evaluating the premises behind it. The second sub-level of this first issue, no thank you, is that you intrinsically create a barrier for individuals who were meritocratic and successful in their fields to be part of the governance, to be part of the crucial social changes in society. Remember, there are successful corporate individuals, for example, or media personnel who became meritocratic and earned wealth and expanded their wealth because of meritocracy. These individuals will have a natural tendency to be part of the governance because of the success that they have. And in society right now, we need those leaders, those social changers, for us to mobilize our ability to change society. Their policy is a great disincentive for those type of people to be part of governance and politics. And we think that that's a dangerous harm for this debate. Yes, Ernest.
Meritocracy for politicians is when you increase the standard of living of people in a country. Why should we really hold to a set particular standard? third group of Muslims. Number one, the meritocratic precedence before they become members of the parliament is being violated by your model. But second of all, I don't think that there's a disjunct between your ability to increase the standard of living of your people and at the same time appreciating the efforts that you have. In fact, the direct meritocratic benefit that you can give to people, Madam Speaker, is when they work hard and the state appropriate your rewards for that. The last idea I'd like to discuss is the principle of the right to property and how that extends to your individuality. Whenever we talk of citizens, Madam Speaker, we're not an individualistic in perspective that will affect their family, that will affect their community, that will affect the rest of the society that are attached to them. Why is this important? We think that their policy is punitive not only to a member of the parliament, but also to the family members who will be affected by such a particular policy. Because the basic social contract that a member of the parliament signs into whenever they get voted and elected in a position is for them to provide services and to realize the promises that they gave to their constituents at the end of the day. We don't think that the appreciation of those social contracts and those promises will be heard if they preserve their ability to provide for the standard of living that they'd like to achieve. In fact, we think that the ability to self-actualize and appreciate your position more is better in the model of side opposition. But at the second level, we think it's fairer for their family as well. We're really part of this sign up or the social contract that the government side placed them in. Overall, then, the next purpose of the next speaker is to discuss really what is the link between advocacy and Yorba, and lastly, in terms of principle, is this really right for individuals, for citizens whose natural rights are that of the liberty provided by the state? Thank you very much.
I thank the speaker's remarks and call upon the deputy leader of the proposition to continue the case for the government side. Hear, hear.
Ladies and gentlemen, there are reasons why a person becomes a politician. It can be because of fame, it can be because of wealth, or it can possibly be because of the ideals that they want to forward. Most of the time, you know, when we look at politicians these days, we wonder whether it's really the third factor, whether it's really about following the ideals of the individuals. Because if you look at it right now, it's basically about who can talk the best, who can be the best person, who's more charismatic. But regardless, I mean, maybe with the Bush administration, yeah, obviously, probably things such as ideals don't really matter. But in these instances, what we want to take out is one factor, the factor of wealth. Because of the fact, that's the deciding factor of these people wanting you to go into the idea, into the realm of politics in the first place. What these guys have to prove to us, taking away that factor, number one, affects that politics itself, and also harms the ideas they want to propagate within today's debate. I have three rebuttals basically coming and completely attacking this side. Number one, on this idea of personal wealth. Because he said he talked about how now this idea of personal wealth also affects the quality of the people and affects the quality of the ideals. Firstly, he never really showed how well does affect those policies. Because if you're really for ideals and you're really for meritocracy, then wealth has nothing to do with it at all. So we don't really see how that forwards your idea as well. Secondly, he talked about how this punishes meritocracy. I have a few responses to that. Number one, we generally elect these people based on merit anyway, sometimes, right? It's based on their manifestos. It's based on what they can actually forward to us. So I don't really see how meritocracy, just because they have a lower income, can be a factor or can be diminished. Secondly, you also see the idea that, look, there are already checks and balances within status quo. If these people are just not as these people just don't have the capabilities as they initially talked about, we can always vote them out in the next elections, or we just don't elect them anymore. So we already see meritocracy in itself is actually happened, because society already has its checks and balances. But lastly, the third response, let's flip it over to that side. You diminish meritocracy. Because let's face it, when wealth does become a factor, and it becomes a factor within these individuals, sometimes people see you buying things within society, is what the example Sadiq talked to you about. It also diminishes meritocracy. I'm electing this person based on meritocracy, but look how he's behaving. He's not forwarding my ideals, and therefore I want to use meritocratic in the first place. Sit down. Now, we also talked about the right to personal wealth and property. Let's just face it, you can always limit these things because Mexican society. Politicians are already susceptible to many things. Paparazzi, right, for example, they follow them everywhere, and their rights of privacy are already invaded because of the fact of what their status is. You also see how these individuals, and you want to talk about self-actualization, the second response is these individuals also probably can't self-actualize. If this individual probably likes hookers or go to strip clubs, he still can't do it because of the fact that he's a politician. So we see that in these individuals, there's also the right of self-actualization will still be diminished. And even more so, even their families are already susceptible to that. Their kids can't have to behave properly because they're just a daughter of a politician. We also see that in these individuals, so what does all these things prove? It proves that these individuals have already limited rights. Their personal rights have been invaded, and we do see, that's why we said it earlier on, it can be extended for towards idea of law. Now, what to my two arguments, right? Number one, how this dilutes the policies and ideals followed by these individuals? And lastly, why this form of representation in this manner is important?
The fact that their rights is already hurt does not mean that we should hurt them more, but protect their rights.
Okay, but you have to tell me how it really does harm them. I mean, we're not actually taking away their entire wealth. They can still spend, they can still live a comfortable life. So please tell me how it's really, you know, that really harmed in this instance. But let's anyway look at the trade-off, right? Whether that kind of choice can be inhibited as compared to the benefits that we can actually give to you. Now let's just go on to the first idea. How this dilutes the policies and ideals forwarded by these individuals. Now just ladies and gentlemen, you might have the same ideals, you might have the same identity that you forwarded, but maybe that's not enough. If you look in the Philippines, for example, let's just take this one example, where the boxer politician, I can't remember his name, but right, where he was criticized for actually buying a yacht and going on holiday during the floods of Mindanao. What does that do? It diminishes your credibility and it diminishes your reputation of what you were originally forwarding when during time of your manifesto. Let's look at it, even in the times of US as well. The US politicians who criticize all the time because this person goes on a holiday to France when they're suffering a recession. You might say, look, this is just not their fault. But this harms the policies and the governments that you were talking about in the first place. Let's face it, right? Look, the voters in the United States is quite devastating. The only time the voters did not spike was when Obama was running for elections. That was a chance for change. You have to have an element of trust of these individuals, of the majority of society, towards their politicians. Let's look at who votes anyway. If you want to talk about these people, eventually vote. Most of the time, it's the elites, or people who really have a strong conviction of what these people are talking about. If you're talking about the average Joe, who actually earns an average income, he probably doesn't really care. And it diminishes the idea of trust that they have towards these politicians because of the amount of spending they have, because of the way that they behave. This affects your policies and affects your governance because your citizens just don't care anymore. Your citizens don't care about the policies, and he just equalizes and generalizes every politician that they have, regardless of whether they're Republican or a Democrat, because of the fact they just lose that trust. So this is where the idea of the second argument comes in. Why is this form of representation important? Because you need to have this form of trust. You need to cater to the majority of society and have that link that you have that link and that sort of middle ground towards every layman within society. Right now, we have to remove this huge factor, which is politicians generally abuse. They get a lot of money, they talk well in front of everybody. But we see that it might not be true, although it might not be true for all these politicians. But this form of representation is the best for society. Because now the calculus of these politicians have to change. Now I can probably get fame and get networks, but now the amount of wealth that I can gain is very much lower. So what does that do? The burden upon me to actually create better policies, the burden upon me to actually follow through with my policies is very much higher as compared to the initial idea of the status quo that they wanted to propagate. So ladies and gentlemen, we've already told you how in status quo there's a huge flaw. The element of income and the element of wealth that these individuals have and the way they spend it does diminish the idea of policies and government. It loses the amount of trust that these individuals have, the layman and the majority of society have towards these politicians. That's why you only have sometimes the Republicans with the elites, for example, voting for these individuals because of the fact that, number one, they are elite, they're right to protect it. These are the only individuals that care. Ladies and gentlemen, we're not harming these politicians. They can still have to lead a comfortable life if we have this income as well. But what we do see is the policies and governments which is still very much hampered and can be damaged under their proposal. What they need to prove to us is how these policies are better forwarded under your model, because that's what you want to propagate in the very deep. With that, we're very much looking forward.
Thank you very much. And now
I'll call upon the deputy leader of the opposition to continue the case with their side. Hear, hear.
It's quite hypocritical for opening government to argue on trust, when in fact we do not trust these politicians with their wealth, and it distracts them from policy. In fact, what they do, Mr. Madam Chair, in terms of trust, especially when trust is usually based on success of these government people, and in fact the reason why they voted in the first place, they violate that trust, Madam Chair, because the government punishes meritocracy by taking away that wealth. So on the first level, we say it's hypocritical that they're arguing on trust. But at the second level, Madam Chair, we don't think that this course is distracted by ostentatious displays of wealth. Because, Madam Chair, it's precisely because the electorate is checking and watching these people that prevents these ostentatious displays of wealth. That is why, as she said, people spoke out against Manny Pacquiao, the champion boxer who keeps on gambling his money away. Surely, Madam Chair, the next election, he won't be in power anymore. And that's precisely why opening opposition does not defend ostentatious displays of wealth. But at the same time, we sit down, we trust the electorate to make the right decision the next time. I don't think there's no one else to trust on that level. The second thing I want to rebut and seal down under is this idea that people can now concentrate on financial empowerment. On the first level, they said they're not making wealth a factor. In fact, what they're doing is that they're making it a factor. The premise of opening government, Madam Chair, is that wealth is a factor in terms of policy making. What opening opposition already has shown you clearly is that when it comes to advocating rights of people on the ground, like those of abortion or those of homosexual rights, it's not wealth that drives you, but your smartness, Madam Chair, your intelligence, your interest in that advocacy, and not wealth. Sit down. The second thing I want to the second level of rebuttal on financial empowerment is that what you're actually incentivizing is a race to the bottom, i.e., tokenistic displays of poverty. They actually want the opening government to utilize the facade of poverty as a political tool. We say this is highly insulting to thousands of poor people in these countries who are genuinely poor and who will be misled by these politicians pretending to be so. This leads me, sit down, to the final level or issue I want to steal from opening government. Their only issue, Madam Chair, is the idea of equivalence. Politicians and people in government have to be the same as the people they're governing. First of all, we say equivalence is not based on financial status, but it is based on the basic level of human dignity afforded to everyone, regardless of that status. Sit down. That includes the right to property, that includes the right to succeed, that includes the right to equality of life, and that includes providing for dependents of your family. What you're actually doing is insulting this sort of equivalence by saying that these people do not have a right to all of these things and that human dignity is less for them and more for other people. What you're actually doing, as proposed by opening opposition, is you're disincentivizing successful people from entering government because you're going to take away the basic level of human dignity. My extension will be very simple. I will answer the question. Will shifting government salaries change policy formulation processes? What is the link, Madam Chair? We say the link between government policy and mindset is based on a conglomeration of experience for what a better society is. Successful people gravitate towards governance, and they tend to be wealthy precisely because they're innovative and they have a unique understanding of their surroundings, allowing them to succeed and become wealthy in the end. So therefore, the reason why they run for office, Madam Chair, sit down, and this is true for a lot of politicians, even if governments already give them a lower salary than they already have in terms of their compensation, is precisely because of altruism, their need to make a change. And that is occurring in status quo. They use their experience in wealth management, and therefore, Madam Chair, this allows them to give them a good part of policy and make good policies for the economy in the future. We see on the first level, management and your ability to be a good politician derives from the ability to focus one's talent on the task at hand. And the reason why status quo is so successful with this is because government ministers do not concern themselves with their financial well-being after their term. Now, what does their policy do? There are three effects, Madam Chair. First, it betrays the altruism and goodwill of the politicians who go into these government positions, Madam Chair and members of this House. In fact, it refrains governance from being service to the people to a destruction of their own self-interest because we need to destroy their own human dignity. But the second effect is more insidious. It causes ministers to look for alternative means of procuring or recouping the financial assets sit down that the government has taken away from them. We see on the first level, this is precisely the incentive for corruption. Because in harming their self-interest, you're forcing them to serve their own self-interest to recoup their losses. But second, if indeed they will go into government policy formulation, they will seek government policies that are friendly to their sector. Like, for example, providing for exit packages once they go out of governance. So overall, what happens is that you force these people to look within and to promote and protect their self-interest. Before I go on, yes.
Look, don't be a lady. It's about PS3 if they still want to, right? We look at the idea of a rich politician who fights for poverty, who is still exposed to extravagance. Diminish his policy and his
ideas. Madam Chair, but you're not punishing extravagance. You're punishing being successful and being wealthy. Because the policy applies not only to extravagant people, but to people who are modest in terms of the way they treat their wealth. So what happens, Madam Chair, if you have that kind of policy, is they cease to be a representative of the people, but they become representative and focus mainly on their own interests. What opening opposition needs is a better world is where ministers are not distracted from the enormous task of state governance, where they are not incentivized to corruption, where altruism, Madam Chair, is not rewarded with financial instability of themselves and their families after they are done in their term. We say, Madam Chair, that politicians have a right to basic human dignity, and removing that right to basic dignity focuses themselves into their own self-interest. And that is the root cause of corruption. We believe in opening opposition that the motion should fall.
I thank the speaker for his speech. And moving on to the second half of the table, I call upon the member of the proposition to continue the case for the government side. Hear, hear.
Right now in the current democratic countries that we're in.
$40,000, to me that's extremely harmful to the society. And this is why I'm telling you, we necessarily remove that incentive for them to be that well. Second, he tells you it's just to how the shiny that the government proposal only uses poverty as a facade of political tool. But tell me, so what if you use poverty as a facade of political tool? But tell me, this is shiny pressing issue for the economic situation in America or other countries are in right now, justify for that facade of political tool. We think that if you use facade of poverty as a political tool, and that's how you motivate politicians to better focus on policies that help assist the economy, we think that if it helps solve the problem, then by all means, we will allow them to do so. Say that. That's the thing, right? They tell you this. Oh, we need to make change. That's how these people who accumulate wealth through being a politics have the experience, and therefore they can make better policy. But still, we don't think that's necessarily true. We think that if you are for the people, right, if you think that the politicians are always for the representation of the people and the ideology of the people, that even if you get paid, say for example, $2,000 a month, you think we still think that politicians can still execute their ideologies and their principles just as well. Now, the section is this. You don't think that all politicians are that kind of nice of politician to begin with, then the question becomes how do you then best remove the incentive, or how do you then best redirect the intention of this politician to begin with? Lastly, more importantly, election tells you this, he accuses us of removing the right to human basic human dignity. Right? We don't think that if you're a politician and if you succumb to wanting to serve the people, then your basic right to human dignity will be to accumulate as much wealth as possible. We think that if you really want to accumulate as much wealth as possible, then we don't think that being a politician is something of a good job for you to begin with, for you to decide to begin with. Yes.
So why are you taking the wealth they earn away? It's not about cutting off the way they earn, you're cutting off what they already earn from them.
We think that's where it's extremely wrong coming from the side of opposition. Because what you fail to recognize is that there's never really a proper external check and balances when it comes to the amount of pays that politicians get. Oftentimes, politicians get to dictate the amount of portion of money that they get, or the budget allocation within